welcome everyone to the first colloquium of the new semester. I'm really happy that we have Prem Chandavarkar doing the lecture this afternoon. Prem is an architect in CNT, which he just let me know is the oldest architectural firm in the city, founded in 1950. But Prem has a range of interests outside of architecture, or maybe he sees architecture as something that is not only architecture, it's a social, cultural, human practice. And this talk today, I'm very looking forward to it. As the abstract let you know, he's trying to rethink the idea of rights in the context of a city where you're not trying to only see it in individual terms. The city is a place of cohabitation.
Okay. Thank you, Chandan. To just qualify that introduction, my firm started in 1950, but I'm not that old. It's gone across generations. So. This is a bit of a speculative talk because I'm a practicing architect. I'm not an academic. I'm talking about human rights without any legal training, formal legal training. But anyway, I think that the notion of tying rights to the city is something that is very important. And I'll go through five sections of the talk. First, I'll present my understanding of the history of human rights, which I believe is not as advanced as we tend to believe it to be. Then, because we have not applied rights to the city, I'll talk about the extent of the fractured city, doing some rough analysis on Bangalore. Then look at the question of citizenship in the city, which has very different dimensions to it compared to at the level of the nation state. And then how both rights and citizenship need to be spatialized at the level of the everyday urban. And finally, just sort of start with some very broad propositions on what a spatial bill of rights might be. So to start with the history of human rights, I mean, the reference document now is the Universal Declaration of Human Rights by the United Nations in 1948. And what is important is that it was the first time the word universal was used in rights. Although rights has an earlier history, dating back to the Cyrus Cylinder, over 2,500 years ago, but this applied only to the citizens of Babylon. Or the Magna Carta, which applied only to a group of barons. Or even the US Constitution, which has been held as a beacon of constitutional rights, affecting, you know, influencing constitutions all across the world, in 1789 did not abolish slavery. And it took close to 200 years more for first the 13th to 15th Amendments in 1865 to 1870. And then the Voting Rights Act of 1965 to really complete the process of at least legislatively putting it down. And if you read the American press today, you'll see that even that implementation is not perfect. It still has major flaws in it. So we tend to think that rights started in 1948, but actually it took a longer time than that. Because there was a recognition, this was a broad definition of rights, but there was a recognition that there are two kinds of rights. Negative rights, which mean that other people don't need to do anything. And positive rights, which mean that someone has to do something. So a negative right is like your right to free speech, which means that other people just shouldn't stop you from speaking. So people don't need to do anything. And they're instantly realizable. Whereas positive rights, like say the right to education or the right to healthcare, means someone has to implement that infrastructure. So these allow for progressive realization. So even the UN process eventually led to two covenants, which are one on civil and political rights, which are the negative rights, and the other on social, economic, and cultural rights, which are the positive rights. And that took a further 28 years, and that process was completed. The development, drafting, signing, and ratification happened only in 1976, which is less than a generation till now. So one could say in human rights, we're sort of still in our infancy, groping along. And I'd like to highlight something that Nancy Fraser wrote about in a book called Scales of Justice. And she points out that scales, when applied to justice, has two connotations to it. One is a traditional figure of justice with a weighing scale, blind. But the other, she said, is the map. When justice is spatialized, and it can happen at the local within a small section, or it can happen at the global level. And her book is actually about how there are patterns of injustice which are globalized, which cannot be dealt with at the national level. And that's a whole different question which I will not get into here. But when we look at the scale, in the traditional sense, it deals with the what of justice. The constitutional foundation, the body of law, the due process of law. But the map says, where does justice occur? That rights are abstract unless there is a spatial entity that enforces them. So you need to be recognized in space. You need to have access to the means of a decent life. And you need to have voice at the level of daily life. So when you compare this to the nation state, which is actually the entity which has been developed so far for the enforcement of rights, and you look and compare it to the city, you find that this is where rights are formally defined, but they have to be negotiated on a daily basis at the level of the city, because the nation state is, I mean, with the exception of a few city states, is too broad and abstract a notion to tie, to connect to the routines of daily life. So if I look at the question of recognition, at the level of the nation state, it's fairly well defined. It's based on citizenship, and that's held stable by immigration protocols. But at the level of daily life, unless you have property rights which locate you in a space, your notion of citizenship is not defined, or you have to be recognized by specific welfare schemes. And since we have a very poorly developed welfare state, or practically non-existent welfare state in India, that has very little definition. And I talk about access to the means of daily life, that's not possible at the level of the nation state, and possible at the level of the city, but unevenly implemented. And it's the same thing with voice. You only have sporadic voice at times of elections at the level of the nation state. Possible at a daily level at the city, but unevenly implemented. So what you have is citizenship is stable at the level of the nation state, but access and voice at the level of daily life doesn't happen. It's possible at the level of the city, but the definition of citizenship becomes a bit problematic. So we have this split that happens. So this is leading to a fractured city, coming to the second point. And I realized this reading this book by Robert Neuwirth, who's a journalist. It's a book called Shadow Cities. And he studies slums in six different parts of the world by actually living in them for 2 to 3 months. And when he is in Mumbai, he's studying Dharavi. A reporter asks him, do you believe the slum constitutes a city within the city? And he thinks about that question, which sounds like a fairly reasonable question to start out with. And he says, actually, 55% of Mumbai's population live in slums, pavements, other forms of informal housing. And it's the wealthy who live in small enclaves. Yet it's the image on the right, which is a city of the wealthy, which is called the city. And the image on the left, which actually has a majority of people, is called the city within the city. So there's some imagination of the city which somehow is broken away from the reality of, you know, where the major portion of the people are. So I started wondering what is the extent of the fractured city, and I started looking at Bangalore, and this is a bit of a back of the envelope calculation, but it gives you an extent of the problem. So this is the per capita income as per the latest survey, which is actually based on 2015 data, 2014-15 data, so it's a little old. So let's round it upwards to 3 lakhs. And as per the census, the average household size is 3.99, so that's the average household income. And then if you look at the distribution broken up by quintile, and this is again a study published in 2007, it's old, but one sees a lot of coverage that the extent of inequality has increased since 2007. So this shows that the top two quintiles capture 70% of the income. So if you break up that average household income as per this split, that's the average distribution per quintile, And then if you look at the expenditure patterns on everything other than shelter, that comes to a little over 80%, which means about 18% is left for shelter. Again, let's make a charitable assumption upwards and take that number up to 30%, because that's accepted as a principle that you should never have to spend more than 30% of your income as, on shelter. So if I, I'm sorry, can you read the figures? Okay, it's not too, I think there's too much light in this room. So so if you look at this, the amount available for shelter per annum ranges from a little under a lakh to about 8.74 lakhs, if you break it up by the quintile. So let's hold these figures at the top of the chart, Q1 to Q5, and compare it to the economics of land. And realizing that there is no real welfare, social housing scheme, which whatever exists deals with far less than 5% of the market. So they're thrown at the mercy of the market. So I took the smallest parcel of land that is recognized in the land use plan of Bangalore, which is 54 square meters, basically a 20 by 30 site roughly. And taking data from some of the real estate clients in my of our office, I took land values at various points, CBD, 4 kilometers from CBD, outer ring road, and the urban periphery. Look what the land value is, let alone the capital value of purchase. Suppose you could get 20-year financing, 100% financing at 8% interest. And if you can find a bank that can give you these terms, please let me know. But suppose you could get that, then those would be the annual expenditures you'd have to incur. Now, the CBD is actually unaffordable to the poor. But you have to realize the periphery is also unsustainable because there is no access to transport and other urban services, access to livelihood, which they would need. So both of these are not feasible. So the poor have to survive on those middle two segments, which if you compare it to the figures on the top, the bottom three quintiles are sort of outpriced by the system. And even the fourth quintile is sort of sitting on the edge. So some of them will be below, some of them will be above. Now you might say everyone doesn't need to have their own plot of land. You can leverage the value of larger parcels of land. So what happens if you take the highest a parcel 1,000 times larger, which is about 13 acres, and apply the highest floor area ratio, which is the maximum you can build, which is 3.25. And taking just 500 square feet per family, which is not very much, and adding the land value, the construction value, you're talking about 1 lakh per annum. However, this is on the urban periphery. So you take it to within the outer ring road, and you're going up close to 2 lakhs, 1.78 lakhs. But 3.25 requires high-rise construction, which requires elevators, firefighting equipment. So it's not just the building cost, it's a maintenance cost. And it has been found that the poor cannot sustain this. And where high-rise solutions have been adopted in the Indian context, it's led to a degraded environment fairly soon. So if I take that, that number comes to about 2.55 lakhs. So which means the bottom two quintiles are priced out, and the middle quintile is sitting on the edge with some of them being priced out. So what we have is a situation where an explicitly defined land use plan, which is a fundamental tool used in urban planning, marginalizes 40 to 60% of the Indian city's population. And that means they're effectively criminalized. Because actually you can legally say, I'm in the city if I have some property rights, either a rental agreement or a sale deed or something like that. If I don't have any of that, I can't locate myself legally on a land use plan. So they're effectively criminalized. They're vulnerable to dispossession and dislocation and have a degraded quality of life. And this is in spite of making all these rather charitable assumptions. So this is not even recognized that we are marginalizing such a large percentage of the population by the mainstream methods of urban planning. And this happens because we don't imagine the city in terms of human rights. That's the extent of the fracture, where more than half the city is sort of outside the system. So how have the poor survived? They've survived because of the space that exists beyond the reach of master planning. Many Indian cities have a large percentage of building stock that predates the idea of master planning. So some of them live there. But that's so the older parts of the city. But that's seen as non-aspirational. If as soon as someone can afford it, they want to move out of there. But also because master planning is weak in ideation as well as implementation, there is space beyond where master planning can reach for the informal systems of tenure by which the poor operate. And the reason master planning is weak is that informality is not just the province of the poor, it's also the elite who don't work by rule of law or transparency or accountability. So therefore the Indian city cannot plan itself because it's all done by backroom negotiations. So, so that limits the reach of master planning. And I think you talk to anyone, they've been through it, and the story is the same in any Indian city. There's a plan that's issued, and by the time the next revision of the plan comes up, everyone's talking about how so little of the earlier plan was implemented. But we are on a collision course, because globalization has changed the perception of India's modernity. Till the 1990s, there was a development discourse that sort of stayed suspended between the memory of a glorious but very distant past and an anticipated technological modernity. But with the success of the Indian software industry, biotech industry, and the Indian metropolis being anchored in global production, now there's a feeling that modernity has arrived. So there's an equation being drawn, globalization equals modernity, and there's an aspiration for the global city which is pushing for the reach of, extending the reach of master planning, which is being pushed further by policies such as the Smart City Mission. And we are going to transition in this century to being a majority urban country. We have been majority rural for centuries. For the first time in history, sometime in the mid 21st century, India will cross the 50% urban threshold. So the contestation over urban space will lead to increasing violence, of which the first signs are already visible. And this is being politically utilized, that exploitation of fear, as a means of political mobilization. So that's just making it worse. And when urban space is fractured, it affects everyone, including the elite. Because any urban service, whether it's water, power, transit, requires a seamlessness of space. But this is causing a fracturing of space, which makes the delivery of any service possible. So our water and power system live with what are euphemistically called transmission and distribution losses, which are in the region of 40%. So what is really needed is a politics of recognition. How can you be in the city and recognized as being in the city? The fact that we're not looking at rights means that we don't recognize a major portion of the population. So that brings me to the question of citizenship. And as I said, it's citizenship is very difficult to transfer from the nation state definition, which is held stable by immigration, to that of the city, because the city thrives on heterogeneity, migration, mobility. So how do you define citizenship there? So if I look at the dimensions of citizenship, there is a legal dimension, which means that I'm a bearer of rights. There's a political definition, which means that I am a participatory agent in the political process. I have a right to participate. And there's a cultural dimension, which is that I'm the sharer of identity. And if I try and locate this in terms of spaces within the city, these categories of citizenship, the legal either exists through property rights or it's found only in courts, which means that if you don't have property rights, the court is your only space. And that means if you're there, your rights have already been violated. So you're already, you know, on the downward slope trying to fight your way upwards again. So the challenge here is how to get out of it is how do you deal with recognition? And if you fail to meet the challenge, you're despatialized, that you don't exist in the city. The political spatialization is sporadic. It happens during elections or when you become part of a public protest. It's not routinized into daily life. And here the challenge is actually one of scale. Because, for example, if something is wrong in your street, you don't know who to complain to. You're forced to go to the central office of the municipality and there's no one person who's accountable for it. Whereas if you decentralize down to the ward or the neighborhood level and urban planning and governance down to that level, then there is a better system of accountability and political accountability can be constructed. But because it is not there, the public realm of the city is rendered, just being passive. So we tend to look at cities where the public, what we call the public realm, are just spaces for movement, consumption, and leisure. It's a very passive realm. If I look at the cultural dimension, what tends to exist is either high culture, which your museums of modern art, etc., or officially sanctioned recognitions of culture. So even if it is, say, to a group that's not economically strong, so it's a definition of, let's say you have a museum of tribal culture. It is, the content of the museum is controlled by bureaucrats and people from the high culture circuit rather than from the people whose culture it is supposed to represent. So there's no space that you can put your culture out there. What that means is that the quest for significance in life is driven into the private realm. There is no public quest for significance, and that is what breeds fundamentalism. Because once significance is privatized, it only seeks people who are similar. It unleashes tribal passions. So what one has to realize is that these three dimensions, there is an impulse at the cultural which is driven to seek similarity. You seek people who are like you, because that is who you can culturally bond with. But the political and legal definitions need to allow for difference. That rights are universalized only when they are granted to the person who is most unlike you. And you acknowledge that person also as a bearer of rights. And because the political and legal are despatialized and rendered passive, what we are seeing is a tendency in India, but in many parts of the world also, for this cultural definition of similarity to seek to appropriate the legal and the political definitions also. So what that means is that if we have to develop the notion of citizenship at the urban level, it can't be based on its juridical foundations like it is at the nation-state level, and it has to be spatialized through everyday routines of inhabitation. So that comes to the spatialization of citizenship. And I draw as an example, I think we have to realize that civic space is something that is not necessarily the same as public space. And the metaphor I use is something that comes actually from the Indian village, but one sees it in cities also, which is a gathering place, which is a platform built around a tree. In fact, the image on the left is from our office, and it is a gathering place there too. And actually, I love the Kannada word for it. It's called somberi katte, which katte means platform, and somberi means a loafer, a lazy guy. And it sees a virtue in a certain kind of idleness, where you just step away from the pressures of life to just engage with your fellow citizens. So if you look at the idea of the civic space, and you say, a civic space is represented by something like the katte or the bazaar, and you compare it to another kind of space which has become a popular hangout kind of space in today's world, which is the atrium of a mall, you realize the difference between the two. That civic space is oriented towards engagement, and the mall is oriented towards visual spectacle. The katte is integrated with the rest of the city or the town or the village or wherever, whereas the mall tends to be introverted away from the city. The katte is open, the mall is gated. The katte is oriented towards slowness and the mall towards speed. And I think this failure to recognize this difference is what has rendered the public realm of cities so passive. But actually, this is not the way cities were meant to be. And this is a book edited by Richard Sennett. And our thinking about cities as a specialized form of study is also not very old. It dates back to the mid-19th century. And Sennett puts together some of the writings of these early philosophers on cities, pointing out that this was the first time to look at the city as a specialized object of study. And all of them picked on the fact that the city is a complex and contested realm that offers freedom through its anonymity. Because in the village, you're under the gaze of tradition, and that constrains your behavior. But in the city where you're anonymous, you can be anonymous in the public realm of the city, you have a greater freedom to do what you want. So some of these writers, like George Simmel, talked about the breeding of a new kind of person he called the urban monk, who could withdraw into himself to think innovatively and creatively, rather than just being constrained by repeating the habits of tradition. Or Robert Park came up with this wonderful formulation that the role of the city is to foreground the moral range of deviant behavior. So the city's vibrancy comes through its diversity than any kind of social consensus like a contract. And our current model of master planning is based on the idea of consensus and a social contract. It's very much affected by that. And Sennett writes in his introduction that the broad humanistic concerns of these early writers has since been lost. And urban studies has retreated into what he calls cocoons of scientific purity, which is based on the urban scholar or the urban planner being an expert and the eminence of expertise, rather than the broad humanistic structures that make a city work. There has been some thinking trying to argue against this in this book by Jeb Brugman, who says that people come to cities to strategically leverage various economies. So the economies of scale, there are more people there. They're densely packed together, it's easier to connect. Because of that, you can form associations and groups which are not tradition-based. And you can even leverage economies of extension, connect to economies outside the city. And he says people are using these strategies in multiple ways. There's no single strategy. So urban planning and governance should focus just on removing conflicts between these various strategies, rather than trying to collapse them into a single strategy like a master plan. So basically, what this all is saying is that we need to articulate a right to the city. And this is something that has been talked about for some time. Not in the mainstream, but there have been many scholars who have been writing about it. And there are two streams which have been taken up. One is called, there's one book which labels them with these words, a reformist, which says the right to what the city has to offer, which is the right to the amenities of the city. And this looks at a citizen that is reasonably well-defined. So it's just that person has been isolated from the amenities of the city, and a reconnection needs to be made. So that needs to focus on politico-economic management, and is largely a governance problem. But there's another one which was first articulated by Henri Lefebvre, and then later on by David Harvey, who it's called the radical orientation, which says that the city is a space, and this connects back to, you know, those early writers on cities saying you develop yourself in the city, you use the space. So it's a right to develop the self in the city. So the city is a space where you're continuously remaking both yourself and the city. And this means a citizen that is never defined, a citizen that's continuously evolving, because you authenticate yourself through dialogue. Right, that's how we normally live. Like, we form friendships, not because we have a contract of friendship, not because we have a philosophy of friendship, but because we dialogue with people, find resonances in common, and therefore discover something both about the friend and about ourselves in the process. This is how we intuitively live. It's not the way we are schooled to think, but it is the way we intuitively live. So what that means is we need to redefine liberalism as a space that offers this sanctuary for this to happen. So to give you an example, take a young Muslim woman who is being told by her family to wear a burqa. Now the fundamentalist will tell her, you must wear a burqa because that's who you are as a Muslim. The liberal will tell her, the burqa is a symbol of your oppression, you must throw it off. Both are actually making the same mistake. They are forcing an identity on the young woman. What she really needs is a recognition that to come out of her conditioning is a difficult and complex process. And she needs a sanctuary of a sheltered space where she can reason her way through it, and whatever she figures will be accepted. And she can continuously sort of critique and authenticate that movement through what she should be and who she is. So it's actually the public realm should be the space of sanctuary rather than some social ideal that the liberal would say or some fundamentalist notion of the traditional city. So if I look for the foundations on which this should happen, which are necessary to go into this model, one is that we need to reform our land markets. Because as any economics class will tell you, prices are determined by the intersection of a supply and demand curve. So if you say the blue line is the supply curve and the red is two levels of demand, you get the difference in price on your left. But because we have inefficient, opaque, politicized land markets, the supply curve is almost vertical. So any slight shift in demand causes a disproportionate increase in price. And as you know, land prices in any Indian city bear no relationship to average incomes. But we also have to look at the extent to which we deal with informality, which we said exists at both levels, at ends of the spectrum. So at the level of the governing elite, we need formalization of procedures for transparency and accountability. But at the level of the urban poor, we need formalization of tenure, because what they need is security of tenure. But we shouldn't formalize life too much. And to illustrate this, I'll cite a theory of slums that was presented by a planner called Charles Stokes way back in 1964, where he divided slums into classes, what he called escalator and non-escalator. Non-escalator is when there are barriers of caste or race or something which prevent coming out of the slum. But he says he divided them into categories of attitude also, slums of hope and slums of despair. And this was basically to argue that each segment, each quadrant of this matrix requires a different strategy. You can't have one strategy for dealing with slums. But what is interesting are the examples he cites for the slums of hope versus the slums of despair. And the slums of despair are largely in the developed world, the banlieues of Paris, the ghettos of the North American city. And this is where life is highly codified, highly formalized, and there's no scope to do anything. So in the sense, what we've had by limiting the reach of master planning is that we've given that ability for hope. And Stokes says that attitudinal difference is actually far more important than the material condition. So what we need is a scope for working with these kind of incremental adjustments. Everything is not too formalized. And to follow a strategy of what the planner John Lerner called housing as above, that you don't seek to legislate everything in terms of products, which tends to drive costs up. The way we specify housing in terms of building codes, product standards, etc., is like saying for cars, the Mercedes car is the safest, so everyone should drive a Mercedes. Obviously, you're going to price most people out of the market, and that's really what we're doing. And Turner shows that when people are allowed to build housing for themselves in incremental stages, because when you are poor, you have to make these daily adjustments. You can't have a pre-specified product thrust down your throat. And then they actually evolve much more efficient solutions. And it's a misnomer to think that the poor have bad housing because they don't have the resources to invest in it. They might not spend lakhs, they might invest 100 rupees a week, but they will invest it, and if they have security of tenure, incrementally improve it over time. And again, there's evidence where people have been granted security of tenure, the slums do improve materially over time. So if I look at the key dimensions of the spatialization of citizenship and rights, one is of course recognition, which has to be dealt with at the level of scale, scaling down, and has to use the principle of subsidiarity, which means that the lowest level does whatever it can, both in planning and administration, and what it cannot do, it delegates upwards. Right now we have a model which is specified at the top level and delegated downwards. And the jumps in the levels of scale can't be too drastic. You can't jump straight from the neighborhood to the whole city. You have, or the street to the whole city. You have to have a graded hierarchy where the jump is not too much. The second is a recognition of difference. And that means you have to have a certain percentage of space, a minimum percentage. There's some studies which say this needs to be in the region of 35 to 40%, which is public, ungated, and civic. And minimize space that is gated and large scale. We are actually going in the other direction. You see real estate developments, and they tend to be larger and gated. In fact, there are some cities which have a code that if, let's say you have a large plot in the city, you're developing a 10-acre parcel of land, you can't keep it as one parcel. You have to divide it up with public roads in between so that it doesn't sort of consolidate space under, you know, certain ownerships. And it keeps the public flavor of the development right through. And you have to have a variegated spatial weave. That means different types, different cultures, different economic classes can't be segregated into zones. Plus, you need to have a variety of sizes. But the last is perhaps the most important, and this was pointed out by Jane Jacobs in her book, The Death and Life of Great American Cities, where she has a chapter saying what kind of a problem is a city. And she cites a scientist called Warren Weaver, who he doesn't use the word emergence, that has come in since. But an emergent system is a system that can display fundamental properties at its core, which did not exist at all in earlier states of the system. Again, that's how we live, right? Friendship. The core of our friendship did not exist in our first meeting, but we evolved and we developed it over time. So one of the key examples that is cited by biologists for an emergent system is a termite's nest. A large termite's nest in human scale is like a megastructure that's maybe 3-4 kilometers wide and 5 kilometers high. And it has functional zoning, it has climate control, it has waste disposal, it has cemeteries to bury the dead. It's a highly organized system, but there's no master plan or termite. And the way it happens is that a termite, when it moves, it exudes a chemical trail called a pheromone. And the termites that follow can sense the pattern of termites that move before it. So they're genetically ingrained with a set of simple rules that if you smell a pheromone trail like this, put a piece of mud like that. So basically, if you look at the conditions of emergence, you leave traces of your action. Those traces are in the public domain. There is an impulse to pattern recognition in the traces. The focus is on direct day-to-day engagement rather than grand intellectual structures. And the system evolves through there are evolutionary iterative spirals by which the system develops and then starts displaying emergent properties that it did not have before. And Jacob argues that the notion of the life of a city, the idea of citizenship, the idea of identity is all an emergent phenomenon. And for that, one thing you need to have is a high degree of pedestrianization, because you can't make those connections unless you're at the pedestrian scale and speed. If you're encapsulated in a car and zipping at high speeds, you don't make the connections. You can drive through the city lost in your car and not be aware of where you've gone. It's very difficult to do that if you're just walking through the city. Unless you're one of those types who tries to text while they walk, but that's another story. But the other thing is you need to have the public traces that you put of your actions. That means you need to have ways of reifying public memory. So memory sometimes is just a memory that is ingrained in a space. I remember my grandparents' home, which I used to visit as a child every summer vacation. And when I went on the next vacation, the memories of the previous vacation was embedded in it, and the house had a new meaning because my memories were written into that continued inhabitation. So you should have that capacity in the city to have your memories there. And another way of reifying memories to make them concrete is through art and culture, through the public realm display of art and culture. So what we need is these memories of civic engagement. And sociologist called Ray Oldenburg coined the term third place, that we have a first place of living, a second place of work, but we all need a third place where we go to build community. So we need to restructure those kind of places. And by bringing this notion of culture into public space, we need to bring into the public realm the quest for significance. So to conclude, what happens if we seek to develop a spatial bill of rights? That we say the foundations of urban planning, design, and governance shift from its current foundation of enlightened expertise to recognition and rights. And I started thinking of, this is a statement by a Sri Lankan architect called Madhura Premathilake, who said, defined a bill of rights for the clients of his architectural practice. So the right to physical and emotional well-being, the right to interact with nature, the right to fresh air, the right to natural light, the right to personalize, and several of these rights. So perhaps we need to construct a urban bill of rights to the level of the city, because architecture is different from the city. Architecture thrives on similarity and on order. The city thrives on heterogeneity and the vibrancy of different orders coming up against each other. But the sort of founding right should be the right to be recognized within urban space. And that's something we need to develop. So from that, we could come up with a set of reformist rights, like the right to security of tenure, the right to housing as a verb, right to education, healthcare, livelihood, to be free of hunger, safe environment, clean water, etc. But perhaps we need to take this broader notion of citizenship, the city as this vibrant place where things happen, and come up with a set of radical rights of the right to the city, the right to prioritize the local, the right to politically engage, the right to contribute to public vision, the right to public protest, the right to be heard in local governance, the right to routinely access public ungated space, the right to inscribe memory in urban space without being routinely subject to erasure by others, the right to authenticate one's being through dialogue with others, the right to be oneself in public, the right to loiter in public, which is actually in India, there's a wonderful book called Why Loiter, written by three women sociologists and architects, saying that the idea of loitering, pleasure without purpose, is a woman is automatically suspect if she seeks to loiter in public space. And if you want to be in that sort of pedestrianized condition of emergence that Jacob writes about, then you should have the right to loiter. The right to publicly seek significance, the right to make public art, the right to engage with art and culture of others. Now, this is just some things off the top of my head. I'm not trying to put this forward as a sort of definitive set of rights, but just as a direction that we need to start thinking of, and that unless we start thinking of this, we'll wind up with what the status quo is, which is the highly fractured city. And the fractures exist in different form in the Indian city, perhaps from an American or European city, but their fractures are there everywhere. because you don't think of the city in terms of human rights. So in fact, let me end with this quotation of David Harvey's, which I think tries to encapsulate the notion of the sort of radical right to the city. He says, the right to the city is far more than a right of individual or group access to the resources that the city embodies. It is a right to change and reinvent the city more after our heart's desire. It is moreover a collective rather than an individual right, since reinventing the city inevitably depends on the collective exercise of power over the processes of urbanization. This is some emphasis I am adding. The freedom to make and remake ourselves and our cities, I want to argue, is one of the most precious yet most neglected of our human rights. Thank you.
Student of cities. You had a question behind.
You might have to set the ball rolling with the first question.
Yeah, please.
No, I said you might have to.
Okay. No. In fact, my question isn't formulated at all. I did think that India has been an urban civilization. We've had a history, but we don't. It's an undocumented, not properly documented. I mean, we have many cities, but in terms of city culture, the way we have Azim, for example, or the 19th century writings you talked about. I would think if we did do that. Because the elements of village life in an Indian city are so heavily present. So the consequences that you pointed out, how public space is apportioned, or how a certain access to space is excessively determined by market structures. I wonder if the consequences may be different here as a result. I'm just thinking aloud.
They are different. One is, while cities have existed since time immemorial, and here I'm making a general statement, not just Indian statement, I'm just emphasizing what I said earlier, the understanding of the city as a specialized condition is very recent. So we are still in our infancy in that understanding. Now in India, the big difference is that the urban and rural are not strict divisions. Okay, as an architect, I deal with the fact that I do projects at construction sites, which, like Shankaranthi, everything will slow down because everyone goes back to the village for a few days. You keep meeting people, whether they're domestic workers or construction workers. You keep meeting people who, even within the nuclear family part, some of them are in the city and some of them are still in the village. So there's still a feeling of being rooted in the village as opposed to the city. So the rural penetrates the urban penetrates the rural. That dynamic is going to change in the 21st century, because we are at 32% urban right now. Now, that's a bit of a dicey figure, because the census defines the urban as population size, I don't remember the exact numbers, density, and percentage of people engaged in non-farming income, livelihood. Now, if you map all those three together, you get one map. If you map each of these separately, you get radically different maps. So that thing of how we define urban is problematic. But the fact is, when you're at about the 30% number, historically, the world over, in all kinds of societies, there seems to be some magic in that threshold where the rate of urbanization rises drastically. It happened in China, it happened in America and Europe, in Japan, in all societies. So there are several projections which say that sometime between 2050 and 2060, we'll cross that 50% number. Now that's, what that means is, if you translate that into absolute numbers, that means the number of new urban citizens added is equal to one European Union. It's like some 400 or close to 500 million. So the numbers are, so what we have to do in a space of about 40 years is what Europe and the United States did over 150 years, and we can't do it using the paradigms they use because they're not sustainable. So we have a sort of radically different challenge. I think life is not going to be as it was in India, and the contestation, the violence of contestation, I think is going to get very troubling. The problem is we have no imagination of the city. When I have gone to many events, even academic conferences, and say we have to build an imagination of the city, I tend to be dismissed as having some esoteric academic interest. They say, the pushback I get is, no, we have real problems of congestion, of housing, of jobs, of infrastructure. We'll deal with those, and once we've made headway, then maybe we'll indulge you and come to your question. You know, that's the kind of pushback. But I think, as sort of, you know, the example of Neuwirth in Mumbai, that we actually are therefore constructing an imagination of the city which is very, very exclusive. So I would agree with you that the rural and urban are not sort of that easy binary that it is in many other parts of the world, and the dynamic is very different here. But I don't think we can build on that fact in any substantive manner, because it's not going to continue as we have known it.
My question was related to how you see the practice of architecture and urban planning in India, and especially because you're talking, because there is a technocratic how to do the practice of it, right? Which is often seen as technocratic, and you're talking of Jane Jacobs, who's critiquing the likes of Le Corbusier for their technocratic high modernist approach to urban planning. So I would like you to talk a little about how you see the practice of architecture and urban planning in India today. Do you see some sort of radical critical ways of looking at this technocratic approach in terms of practice or not?
It's definitely one that I'm pursuing, but whether that's a mainstream pursuit, I'm sorry to answer no. It isn't. There is a belief in these two professions, perhaps a little more so in architecture, because architecture doesn't need to base itself on empirical foundations as much as urban planning has to believe that the meaning in one's work comes from what I, as the creator, have put into it. So therefore, I have come up with this wonderful idea, and therefore it is valuable. Whereas actually, my argument is that what you can do is you can construct a framework, you can construct an aura of a place, a character of a place. But then there's a process that actually starts after you've completed your creation and stepped away from it, a process of inhabitation, which then breathes meaning into it. And that process is something that very few architects tend to think of. They still tend to have that more technocratic, I am the enlightened creator kind of attitude. So, which is why I would argue for a rights-based approach, whether it's Madhura Premathilake talking at the level of architecture, what I'm trying to explore, but at least it accepts this, the value of inhabitation as a way of generating meaning. I talked about, for example, the inscription of memory into space. There's a wonderful essay by Primo Levi, where he's writing about his house. And he talks about a technique used by the orators of ancient Rome who had to remember speeches without the use of paper, because paper was not an available commodity. And apparently the way they remember their speech was that they used the architecture of the place where they were going to speak. So they'd go into the room first and they'd say, the entrance door stands for my first point, the column next to it for my second point, the niche next to it for my third point, etc. It said that the more skilled of them could go through a logical argument backwards by just reversing the sequence with which their eye traversed the room. And Levi says that this technique could never work for me in my own house because every corner is already occupied by authentic memories which would interfere with the fictitious memories that this technique demands. So I think what he's saying is that there's a process of inhabiting space which, you know, builds this memory. And maybe the success of my work comes from the way I empower and appropriation by others rather than the value of this wonderful creation I have offered to the public. But unfortunately, the mainstream and the way training is done is privileging this notion of enlightened expertise, and that by my training I'm going to be one of those enlightened experts. So one is trying to fight it, but.
Are there interesting interventions or sort of radical?
There are a few, but they're
not really.
People like me working in some corner of the world where no one hears of us. So there are a few. I wouldn't say nobody is working on it. There are a few, but it's definitely far from the mainstream. And architecture has actually come up with a different kind of problem now because of the digital circulation of imagery. There was a time that to be considered a radical thinker, a radical creator, you put forward a radical theory or a radical philosophy. I mean, that's what all the 20th century masters did. And the day-to-day protocols were seen as subjective and private and were screened from view. But now digital production has given the day-to-day protocols a very seductive look. And after deconstruction, theory has been discredited, so, or at least lost its certainty. So now theory is hidden and this day-to-day imagery is put forward as the evidence of being radical. And therefore there's this compulsion and quick decisions made just on visual appeal rather than reasoned, which in the days of the attention economy is unfortunately again something that's spreading.
Wait.
I think you need a mic for the recording.
Good afternoon, sir. Since we are talking about urban India, and as you mentioned that 50% of the Indian population will soon become urban, considering Bangalore, it is one of the most cosmopolitan cities of South India. Bangalore faces a lot of problems regarding water or other things like refuse, natural refuse. And there are only few cities in South India, let's just talk about South India, that which is well equipped with refuse. One of our professors, he was doing some research, and according to him, Kochi is one of the cities which has 98% people have septic tanks, but that is not the case for Bangalore. So is India really ready for such high level of urbanization? Like other countries like China, their step forward to modernization was quite gradual, but is India really ready for urbanization? Like such,
I wouldn't say China's shift was gradual, but I would say that's not an admissible question, because whether we're ready or not, urbanization is coming. You know, it's like the child who's the seeker in the game of hide and seek says, ready or not, here I come. And that's what urbanization is going to do to us. It's coming. So we have no choice but to get ready. And I think the imagination of the city that imaginations of the city that we construct have to sort of build on that. For example, you talked about waste management, or you talk about food production, or you talk about the water cycle. The problem is that we tend to, maybe this is because the history of cities first came up as fortified entities, you know, with a protective wall around them. That's where the medieval city first came from, at least the cities that we still recognize, where we see traces of. So we tend to think of the city as a bounded entity, and what's inside is urban and what's outside it is rural. Now, leaving aside what I said about the rural and urban penetrating each other in India, even in natural systems it's that way. And a thinker called John Thackara proposed a metaphor. Think of the city as a sponge. A sponge is a bounded entity, you can recognize its form, but it also has pores where energy and other resources can flow through it. So there are ways we need to, if you look at the city as a sponge, if you look at the city as decentralized, Bangalore, for example, used to be planned as a system of watersheds. What is a watershed? A watershed is a space between ridges and valleys where water behaves and collects in a certain way. So it was a city of tanks, which could have, if that system had been respected, that could have made Bangalore self-sufficient for water. Our office is doing a project for the Indian Institute of Management in Trichy, which is not a high rainfall zone. We have the advantage of a large site, but we're harvesting water. It's not going to happen instantly. It takes a few years for the system to stabilize, but we're going to make the, we have 6 acres of man-made lakes in the campus, and we want to make that campus self-sufficient for water. But you start thinking of this, you know, the city as a sponge, you start seeing suddenly potential in small spaces which can come into the system. If waste management could be decentralized to the ward level, what I talked about, the principle of subsidiarity, that would change things drastically. Another great example of the city as a sponge, what happened to Havana, Cuba? Cuba was a country that depended on a subsidy from Russia, what was then called the Soviet Union. And after the Soviet Union fell apart, suddenly that subsidy disappeared overnight, and their food was based on imports through Russian support. That system suddenly disappeared. So they started following a strategy of growing food within the city. And they started pulling in people, like even if you had 100 square feet in your garden, you could spare to grow food. People were growing food in pots, in verandas and balconies. And the city supported it with the inputs and also the distribution system. And within a very short period of time, I think barely a decade, 50% of Havana's fruits, vegetables, grains were produced within the city's boundaries. So if we change, I mean, these are the kind of things we need to think of. But we can't think of that because of what I said, informalization of the elite. That the city doesn't work according to these kind of systems, which is based on popular energy, which is based on emergence. So we tend to have these kind of opaque transactions which prevent the city, Indian city, from planning and managing itself. So it's people like us who now have to come together and sort of fight for these kind of causes. And the models are there. There's a technique of urban planning which was pioneered by a person called Ian McHugh, published a very influential book in the early 60s called Design with Nature. And there's a way of mapping a site in larger developments, and this would apply to urban plans also, where you map it from its topography, its soils, its vegetation, its aspect, and various other things, and you can overlay those maps and read them in a way that you can figure out how to put development and still respect the natural systems of the city. So that's a technique that's been on the table for more than 50 years now. Till the 2007 master plan of Bangalore was the first master plan that recognized the topography of the city. The earlier plans, plan documents showed the city as a flat plain. This was the first one which used satellite mapping to map the rivers and valleys and define certain protected zones. And I mean, how effectively that's done is another story. But we're still early in that process. And urbanization is coming, whether we want it or not. We have not. The only question is, how can we get ready for it? And a lot of it will not be people migrating to cities. In fact, the growth rate in the large metropolitan cities is still high, but it's decreasing. A lot of it is going to happen in the tier 2, tier 3 towns, and in areas which are currently classified as rural, which will transform into being urban. So it's not the dynamics in the metropolitan city that we got to look at.
Prem, continuing the question that Sushmita asked, I mean, the missing activism among architects. Why do you think the Laurie Baker movement was a movement, however small it was? It was a discernible movement. People went out to different cities and had arguments to offer on why certain kind of buildings are good to build. But if urbanization is this serious and we are having smart cities, etc., one does look for dissent among architects, bodies of architects, working as conscience keepers and pressure lobbies, etc.
Yeah, I wish it were so, but unfortunately it doesn't happen. And part of what has happened is that we have people who are in positions of power, where their power comes not from their ideas or their ideals, but comes from other political systems. And they become very resistant to any alternative model. When I was in college, I went on a study tour to Kerala. And we spent a couple of days looking at Laurie Baker's work. And we were very, unfortunately, he was not there. We couldn't meet him. And we were very excited. And then at the end of the second day in the architecture college in Trivandrum hosted a dinner for us. And the head of the college refused to talk about Baker. In fact, in his speech, I remember him saying, there's this brick mason here who calls himself an architect. So there is that kind of disdainful kind of resentment that comes. That's part of it. The other part of it is the way all of us are trained to live in what Sennett calls the cocoons of scientific purity. We construct some notion of the purity of our discipline and refuse to engage with a wider question. And I was telling some of the youngsters in my office today is that you can't be neutral on politics. The decision to say, I won't be political, I won't comment on politics, is tantamount to an endorsement of the status quo. So unfortunately, not people realize that and believe that they can live in their cocoons and are very protective of it.
Yes.
Sir, the structure of the urban space from a social angle is somewhat determined.
The structure of the urban?
Urban space or the city, space, as okay. We call yeah. it. So, is somewhat determined by the urban middle class mentality, where we see a notion of segregation or separation from the lower class people. So, given such a situation, as you mentioned about building more public spaces where people from all classes can have access. Will that work, or as you mentioned, some of the rights like which can be addressed, which can be given in an urban space to the people of all classes. So will that work given such kind of a mentality where already people have this sense of separation?
It won't work if you just tackle them in the same mentality, but I think we have to shift the terms of the discourse a bit. If someone says, I want to protect my way of life, okay, let's take for example, we see a lot of Hindutva ideology today. So there is an argument, that mainstream argument, that in the resistance to Hindutva, which will put forward the argument of secularism or the argument of constitutional rights, etc. I think that kind of an argument is not going to hold much weight, because it tries to counter an emotional state of mind with a logical argument. In politics, emotion will trump logic any day. Okay, so it's not going to work. But what you have to do is say that I am wary of Hindutva not because of secularism. You have to use this also, and it's a valid argument. I'm not saying it's just a strategic choice. So say I'm wary of it because I want to protect Hinduism. That Hinduism is this multiple space, it's this complex space, and as soon as we, I mean, I got into arguments with a relative of mine once. Actually, after Babri Masjid, I think many of us suddenly discovered how many fundamentalists we had in our circle. And he was putting forward these arguments. I said, if you surrender to this, one day someone will tell you, you can't worship like this. You can't go to the temple. Or it's like Yogi Adityanath tells Siddharamaya, prove your Hinduism by refusing to eat beef. Someone will start telling you how you should live as a Hindu. So that's threatening your notion of Hinduism. So really that one has to start using those arguments and popularize them. So as I said, the impulse towards community is that of constructing similarity. The impulse towards rights is that of allowing difference. Now, if you ask people, forget your similarity and look at difference, they're not going to do that because they feel vulnerable. Say that actually to protect your similarity, you need difference. Because you're saying that without that, I will be like a body that has lost its immune system. You know, a body that is in too sterile an atmosphere can't deal with change. A new organism comes in, it collapses. So it's the same thing. If I can't, I might have that impulse to similarity, to community, and that's a fundamental impulse. It should be allowed. But if I say that's all there should be, I'm actually sowing the seeds of my own destruction. And so it's got to be an emotional thing. It's got to be, you've got to meet people on the ground on which they're standing. Not saying ignore that ground and look at this ground. So I think we have to start doing things like that. But if we don't do that, then we'll face what we're facing, where the notion of construction of similarity at the cultural level starts trying to take over the legal and political aspects of citizenship also. But the middle class aspiration is a dangerous one as far as urban planning goes, because it's right now it's an aspiration to the global city. You're seeing it in cities like Bangalore, the activism of what are called resident welfare associations, which are pushing a global city narrative. And given that if we push for the extended reach of master planning in a paradigm where the model of master planning excludes a majority of the citizenry, we're on a collision course, which is going to get very violent.
So over the winter break, I spent a few weeks working with this rehabilitation site where people from informal settlements had been relocated to. And in some of the articles that I'd read about this particular site, the term vertical slum was used consistently. And I was wondering if you'd be able to kind of give me an insight into the usage of that term, because when I spoke to the people at the site, there was this kind of move to kind of embody, I suppose, the living living conditions of more middle class sections of society. I mean, there were rules as to how people should behave now that they have apartments, now that they have more structured shelter. So I was just wondering, given that these kind of behaviors are being adopted, why the term vertical slum? Why we still call it a slum in sense?
There are two aspects to this. One is what I talked about, high-rise structures, where one is they have systems such as elevators for safety, certain kind of firefighting provisions, which are not just expensive to build but expensive to maintain. So they become difficult, and a lot of urban poor are rehabilitated in high-rise structures, they degrade very fast because they can't. And they also live a lifestyle, a job pattern, etc., which needs to be close to the ground. Person-to-person engagement. There's a daily negotiation of life that goes on, which if you're isolated on the 10th floor or something, you can't do. But the other thing, I think, is tied to what John Turner called housing as a verb. That housing is a means by which I improve my life. So there's a book by an architect called Christopher Alexander called Notes on the Synthesis of Form, one of his early writings, written I think 50 years ago. I mean, the main thing of the book is not of interest, but there's one chapter on which where he takes the example of an Indian village house. Indian is talking about here in India, he's not saying American India. And he says, why does the house seem to have this wonderful fit between culture and climate? The form of the house, it's adjusted so well, as opposed to a lot of contemporary housing. And he says the reason it does that is because it adapts gradually over time. Perhaps it started with one room and the person lived in that room for some years. And then he was working with mud and tile and materials. He could work on himself also. So maybe he added another room. Then maybe his son saw how it was behaving in a storm and put a veranda in front to shelter it, something like that. So he says you're dealing with one variable at a time and then you can adapt. Whereas modern housing tends to try and get all the variables right at one time. Now when I'm designing for the affluent, they have means of adjusting if I get something wrong. It might be in furniture there or artifacts they buy. It might be in some, they've spent some money in renovations 2 years after living in the house, whatever. But poor people do not have that. The other thing is, especially in a country like India, the urban poor, the circumstances are very rapidly evolving. Say a person is not able to make ends meet in the village. He comes to the city because he's coming by himself, and there's someone from his village who'd gone there before. That person says, oh, you can come and stay with me initially. So he leaves his wife and his children behind. Then maybe he realizes something, but he can't call his wife and his kids, but he calls his brother because they can do something. Then after some time, the brothers make separate houses, and then they each call their wife and kids. Then maybe they call their parents. So a lot of people go through these sort of rapid adjustments in a very short space of time. It might happen within the first 5 years of moving to the city. They might leave the city and go back to the village for 2 months at a time during harvest time or something like that. So their needs of housing are very rapidly evolving. So as soon as you push their housing as a product and say this is where you live, and you know, you're straitjacketing them into something that they might not be ready for. Quite often, a lot of them realize, if they get a resource, they realize the market value of that resource, trade it in, and go and live in another slum. So So Turner says you, as soon as you define housing as a product, you say it's from the safety point of view, but safe, there are other ways of tackling safety rather than building rigid building codes. So he gives the equivalent that the way we specify housing is like saying for cars everyone should have a Mercedes because that's the safest car. So we structure, we have an industry of housing, and A, which because of the way it's codified raises price barriers too high, and B, because it's not adaptable, is not suited to the actual conditions. So there is a lot of documentation to show that when people are allowed to build for themselves, the results are much better than professionally delivered solutions. Which is not to say that professionals have no role, but the role can perhaps change. Rather than say, okay, I'm going to be the architect, I'm going to design this house completely, I'll get it constructed, then after that you can enter the picture. So I read a case of an architect in the United States who worked in the Appalachian Mountains, one of the islands of fairly high levels of poverty in the United States. And he was supported by some public funds, but he used to run a process which he called the architecture clinic, which was like a doctor's clinic, which he said, these four evenings in the week, I'm going to be there. And people would come and say, I need to add a door over here, how do I do it? Oh, my roof is built like this and it started to leak and it's starting to sag, what do I do? So you offer very specific solutions of expertise, of just a very specific question, not holistic, deliver a whole product kind of thing. So because the current method of housing as a product and the method of project delivery is so badly suited to the actual needs and living patterns, the shifting needs, it often just breeds more slums, whether they're vertical or not.
Most of the cities in India are not planned, well planned. So I'm basically from Telangana. So there is a lot of leakages, drainage leakages on the road in the rainy season, and we are aware of that. So with lot of political pressure, so the government of Telangana announced that for a complete change in the system of drainage, it will take 10,000 crores in Hyderabad, only in Hyderabad. So same, not only in Hyderabad, it is the same in a scenario of Bangalore or Chennai. We can see the leakage of drainage on the roads in the rainy season. So my question is, what is the role of these development authorities and the government apart from constructing flyovers and parks?
This needs a little bit of going into the history of local government in India. Is that what not many people realize is that when we wrote the constitution, we didn't recognize local government. And that is because there is a conflict between two points of view. One epitomized by Gandhi, who said prioritize the local, and the other epitomized by Ambedkar, who said that the local is captured by caste imbalance, and to prioritize the local is to perpetuate that caste imbalance, so you need strong central control. So what resulted is in the, I don't know if everyone knows this, or am I just repeating familiar history? But as a result, we just recognized central and state government, and state government was given instructions to set up local government. Then it was discovered that this was not happening. There was too much interference in the local. So we had the 73rd and 74th amendments, which were passed in the early 90s. And the amendments are broad, and the states were asked to write the detailed rules by which these would be implemented. which I thought was crazy, because it's like asking the fox to write the rules for the chicken coop. Because the problem had come up because of state government interference. So what has happened is a technical adjustment of the rules, which has largely preserved the status quo. And in some case, deliberate sort of non-recognition of the constitution. So you look at the case of Bangalore, I'll know the specifics in that case. So how can the city, for example, you look at drainage. Drainage is under the BWSSP. Sorry, it's under the BBMP, the municipality. Water supply is under the BWSSP. So they're under two separate agencies who don't talk to each other. And in ecological planning would say that you have to look at the complete water cycle, but you have split these apart. The BWSSB, the BDA, which is a planning authority, BESCOM, which is the electricity power authority, and many of these are what are called parastatals, who do not report to local government. They report to the state government. Law and order is directly under the Home Ministry. So you're getting this fragmentation, which allows what I call the informalization of the elite. So which is why the Indian city in its current structure cannot plan itself. What you have to do is all the aspects of city life have to be under the autonomous control of local government, and even that has to be decentralized. Karnataka even ignored some constitutional provisions, like it was required that a city above 10 lakhs of population had to create what was called a metropolitan planning committee, where 2/3 of its members are elected. So there's democratic oversight of the planning process, and the MPC is supposed to conduct planning. The MPC was not constituted till 22 years after the amendment was passed. It's just been constituted, and it's not taken on its role. It's delegated planning back to the BDA. In fact, there's a case against that right now, which is going on in the court. Again, a metropolitan city was supposed to decentralize into wards. The rules for ward committees was finalized in June 2017. And that was only because of a case filed in the High Court by an environment group on the waste management issue, saying that waste management should happen at the ward committee. And the High Court twisted the arm of the state government to finalize the ward committee rules and create ward committees. So right now we have this very dysfunctional system. There's no planning in the real sense of it. Even the construction, you said, do they do anything besides constructing flyovers? Yeah. Flyovers doesn't even resolve the problem. In fact, a national transport policy defined at the central government says road widening and flyovers is not the way to go, because it incentivizes private transport, so it incentivizes congestion. And if you don't look at the road network as a system, building a flyover just relocates congestion, it doesn't solve it. So actually there is no, even if there's someone in one of the branches of urban governance who wants to do something, it's very difficult. It needs systemic reform, and I hope places like Azim, Premji, University will become think tanks for this, propagating this kind of thinking in a very strong way. I think we've run out of time. Thank you very much.